Hi guys, and welcome to the first edition of STEMdemic Month with Physics Society, where we find curiosity in solitude. How does it feel to be alone?
Wait, what?
No, I mean alone at home, like home alone. We were alone in life anyways.
What was that?
Nothing.
Okay. Well, to answer your question, I'm doing fine at home. I miss talking to my friends in real life and all of that, but technology exists and I'm making the best out of this time.
Right, that's great. It is so important to remain active when you are at home. Don't let that loneliness get to you.
I'm not alone.
Anyways, with no further ado, let us introduce to you our first guest speaker. Through our weekly podcast, we hope to keep you guys posted on a few of the most interesting aspects of physics.
Yes, things you don't learn at school.
The secrets of the universe.
Its destructive potential.
And its most beautiful aspects.
Let's give a ring to Taru.
Oh, hi guys. I didn't see you there. Welcome to my lair, filled with unexplored ideas, imagination, and a constant thirst for knowledge and innovation. This is my sidekick.
I'm sure we're all waiting for an exciting adventure in this room of yours. We'll get started on that right after we invite our next guest speaker, SP.
Just breathe. Listen to the rivers running, the birds singing, and feel the endless void of space.
Here's the question of the day. If you were a space voyager, what would you do?
Right. Imagine that you had with you a team of hundreds of people, all at your command, all the resources that you need, and a superb spacecraft with the most excellent propulsion system.
Oof, God, don't nerd out about such things. These people want to see explosions. They want cool alien noises. They want to be sucked into the madness of space. So let's give them that.
Yeah, I get the idea. Let's ask our guest speakers, what would you do?
Become the master of the universe.
What?
Those are quite some diverging thoughts. Let's start with Tarunyaa. Why do you want to become the master of the universe?
Well, I've always believed that it is humanity's destiny to conquer the universe and achieve the true potential as a race. And this potential is actually outlined by something called the Kardashev scale, which is essentially a method of measuring a civilization's level of technological advancement based on the amount of energy that they are able to use. And according to this scale, there are three levels of development that human civilization can achieve. And I aspire to lead up to achieve the third level. So firstly, a type one civilization. This is also known as a planetary civilization. And this type of civilization can store all of the energy that's on that planet. So we will be able to store all of the energy that's hitting our surface through the sun's rays and that's there in the waves of the planet and all of the hydroelectricity and everything. A type 2 civilization is also called a stellar civilization, where we'll be able to capture all of the energy from our neighborhood star. So for us, it would be the sun. And a type 3 civilization, also known as a galactic civilization, can control energy at the scale of its entire host galaxy. So for us, it would be the Milky Way. So Kardashev, the person who proposed this scale, he didn't believe that a type 4 civilization could exist, but I do. I think that there's potential for us to become masters of not only our solar system and galaxy, but we can become masters of the universe and our multiverse. But it is a bit of a futuristic thought, because at this point of time, we're still a 0.73 civilization. We haven't even reached the level of a type 1 civilization. But being the meticulous person that I am, with a hunger for knowledge, I would like to unlock all the secrets of the universe. Only one can do this by only becoming its master, bringing humanity to the level of a type 3 civilization, exploiting the resources of the universe, and eventually possessing an infinite amount of energy.
What? Why would you want to do that? Why would you want that? There's so many beautiful things out there, things that'll be ruined if we interfere in them. Since I witnessed my first annular solar eclipse, I have always dreamed of becoming a space explorer. I want to travel to every corner of the cosmos and document all the beauties it has to offer. For example, here are a few of the universe's prettiest phenomena. Gamma ray bursts. These are the most energetic and luminous explosions in the known universe. They typically occur when a dying, rapidly rotating star collapses and becomes a black hole and emits a narrow beam of intense radiation near the speed of light. Causing an explosion with a fountain of color. How can you exploit something so beautiful? What about a neutron star collision? These are the densest stars in the universe, so dense in fact that when they collide, they create new elements that are responsible for the spectrum of colors visible when they collide. Some even believe that we humans are made up of neutron star dust. And surely, even you cannot be oblivious to the existence of black holes with their accretion disks. Places in space where gravity pulls so much that even light cannot get out. How can you seek to stifle something so powerful?
Well, I don't think that the universe is as beautiful a place as you describe it. It's actually quite destructive. The phenomenon that he just described, such as the gamma ray bursts, neutron stars, black holes, they're all very, very destructive. The universe is not a utopia. We have to make the best use out of it. It's our responsibility to harvest all of the resources that it offers, just so we can ensure our survival and advancement as a human race.
Well, the universe is not your playground. Anyways, how do you even go about doing all that in the first place?
Well, I'm glad you asked that. The simple answer is STEM, science, technology, engineering, and math. These are tools that we manufacture to make sense of the universe, and today, we can use it to bring it down to its knees. First, we don't have to travel very far for this one, but we can begin by colonizing the moon and establishing a moon village over there on the rocky object orbiting the Earth. And this would be an astronomical research area for tourism and maybe even geological exploitation. And it would actually increase the amount of minerals that we have on Earth. We could also get helium-3 resources that would help us for our nuclear fusion reactors. And a lot of people are trying to aspire to do this, so why can't I do the same?
But...
No, I'm not finished yet, okay? What about the unlimited potential of asteroid mining? There are thought to be 150 million asteroids in the inner solar system alone. And that's only the ones that measure about 100 meters or so. So that means that there are billions of dollars of worth materials are actually orbiting there in space, and how could you just let them be? These asteroids can provide us with gold, platinum, cobalt, zinc, tin, lead, silver, copper, iron, rare earth metals, and possibly other yet-to-be-discovered resources for industry and innovation. And what about the potential of our sun? We take it for granted because it's there in our sky every day. But do you know the amount of energy it espouses? It shines with the energy of a trillion nuclear bombs every second. And if you could surround this with a bunch of satellites that we created, we would be able to harvest the energy of the sun. And even 1% of the sun's energy would be 200 billion times as much energy as we have now. And this megastructure can be called the Dyson Sphere. And with this build, the opportunities for humanity are endless. How can you suggest that we leave the greatest frontier in human history, space, untouched?
That is basically colonizing space. How do you think the Indians felt when the British colonized their country? Would you appreciate that sentiment?
Well, there is nothing out there in space. No one's living there. At least, I hope so.
Well, I believe that we must have humility and gratitude for the fact that we are privileged enough to be intrinsic observers of the universe. As Neil deGrasse Tyson said, we don't live in the universe. The universe lives within us. We are all made of stardust, and we must appreciate our home, not destroy it. We can't make the same mistakes that our ancestors made on Earth. Here are some examples of the beauty of the universe. Look at all these pretty pictures that you usually see as desktop backgrounds, and let's understand what they truly are. Firstly, the Orion the Hunter. Orion the Hunter with his belt and sword is a familiar presence that you can most definitely see in Singapore at this time of the year. It's composed of very bright, faraway stars and nebulae. Looking at the sky in different spectra reveals very different portraits of the visible universe, including the deepest view of Orion Nebula ever taken.
All right. Yeah, I've seen it actually through a telescope in Singapore, the Galaxy CC. It was quite a sight.
Exactly. Even if you are somehow blind to the beauty of Orion the Hunter and other such beauties of the universe, surely even you guys can appreciate the coexistence of millions of gravitationally bound stars and space dust held together in a supermassive black hole to form beautiful galaxies floating around in space. The Andromeda Galaxy and our Milky Way Galaxy reign as the two most massive and dominant galaxies within the local group of galaxies. However, they are soon about to collide. In about 4.5 billion years, the Milky Way will collide with the Andromeda Galaxy. And their ship name is said to be the Milkomeda or the Milkdromeda. As the galaxies approach each other, trillions of new stars will be added to the night sky. And the sky will glow bright and colorful as the compressed gas and dust collapse to form new stars. Can you imagine going to sleep with the sky looking like this?
You guys are definitely two sides of the coin.
You can take it in both ways, superposition. While the universe is a force of beauty and destruction, to be cherished and to be feared of, we must advance the knowledge of the human race in a way that is sustainable. Yes, we must know to stay within our bounds and be humble, but at the same time, we must develop our civilization for the betterment of mankind.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. What if something goes wrong on Earth? What if we all die in nuclear warfare, get hit by an asteroid, or die in a pandemic?
Not so subtle reference there, but I agree with you. I think that we must strike a balance. I don't think that we should be so power hungry as to exploit every aspect of our universe. We should also not be so lax that we don't develop any of our space technology at all. We must be prudent.
You're so philosophical. This is the reason why I say you're lonely.
Huh?
Bye.